people and gods, in the days of innocence, in the era of myth. Deserted cities and mysterious masks unveil an ancient, unsolved mystery. On July 18, 1986, construction workers in Yue Liangwen Village, Sichuan Province, were scooping out soil to make bricks when they came across some scattered pieces of jade. They were buried close to a large mound known as Sanxingdui. Staff from the Sichuan Provincial Cultural Relics and Archaeology Research Institute soon arrived on the scene, and before long they brought out of the ground a grotesque item made of bronze. It was a startling bronze head sculpture with protruding eyes and pierced ears. On the lower jaw of the mask, there were burn marks, which suggested the mask had been burnt before being buried. Eventually, a large number of bronze head sculptures were unearthed, all of them exotic in appearance and in a variety of shapes. It was a veritable bronze empire of sculptures that included both dignified men and graceful women. On August 29th, as the excavation work was drawing to a close, on the western edge of Sacrificial Pit 1, archaeologists found an object made of gold. After the dirt was removed from the object the archaeologists found, they were looking at a gold scepter more than a meter long. Inside was residue comprised of carbonized wood. The discovery of the scepter was a huge surprise to the archaeological team, as in ancient times, objects made of gold were considered precious treasures and were thus rarely used as burial objects. Never before had a gold scepter like this been found in China, and it had been buried. Even more unexpectedly, yet more gold objects were found at the site. The world's most famous ancient gold artifact is probably the gold mask of Tutankhamun, the 11th pharaoh of the 18th dynasty of ancient Egypt. Interestingly, it looks not dissimilar to the gold masks found at Sanxingdui. Why would objects such as these, in the styles of West Asia and the Middle East, appear in central China? These are typical examples of bronze items unearthed in central China. They are in a completely different style to the bronze figures found at Sanxingdui. Gold masks and scepters in the style of those discovered at Sanxingdui have never before been found in other parts of the country. The earliest Chinese ritual vessels appeared more than 4,000 years ago in the Xia Dynasty, and most of them were made of bronze. The ritual vessels were used in ancestral temples or royal palaces for sacrificial rituals, imperial pilgrimages, banquets, and various other important events. In the Zhou Dynasty, which followed the Xia Dynasty, ritual culture reached unprecedented heights. The tripod was considered a symbol of sovereign rights. We know from historical records that dukes and princes were allowed to use 9 tripods in their rituals, whereas ministers of the crown were allowed to use just 5. It's said that the king of Zhou was entitled to use 12. The bronze items unearthed in Sanxingdui are mostly bronze figures with protruding eyes, pierced ears, and high-bridged noses. They look rather more like Westerners than Chinese people. Is it possible that 4,000 to 5,000 years ago, a tribe of people with Western facial features lived in the Sichuan area, and that they cast these bronze figures based on their own appearance?
那么当时有人猜测，这可能不是我们这个中国文化的东西，但是它毕竟出在我们四川，出在三星堆啊，应该是古蜀国的东西。
As no inscriptions have been found at Sanxingdui, we have no clues as to the relationship between these exotic figures and the ancient Shu kingdom. But some clues about the ancient Shu kingdom have been found in the oracles of the Yin ruins. In the oracles, the character of Shu appears frequently. Some scholars believe it refers to an ancient kingdom in southern China called Shu. A book about the ancient history of southwestern China, Chronicles of Hua Yong, includes a few references to the ancient Shu kingdom. Among them is the following. San Song, the first king of Shu, has protruding eyes.
有的认为这个钟楼是像二郎神神话传说当中二郎神儿中的第三只眼，那么有的认为他可能是在眼球上刺青。Only
a few references to the kingdom and its king have been found in historical records, and these alone were not enough to confirm the origin of the Sanxingdui bronzeware. That is, until the discovery of this bronze object. This large bronze mask has tilted eyebrows, a mysterious smile, and large ears that look like extended wings. But perhaps the most striking feature is the dramatically protruding eyes. They stick out no less than 16 centimeters.
This image can be said to be an object of art, a work of art. Following this object's removal,
Legend
has it that the people of Sansong's clan originally lived in hardship among the caves in the Minshan Mountains, but that one day, while patrolling the outskirts of the clan's domain, San Song, with his protruding eyes, spotted a vast expanse of fertile land on the Chengdu Plain. He then led his people on a migration, and despite extreme hardships along the way, they reached their fertile new home. It seems highly likely that the descendants of Sansong, inspired by the legends of his historic deeds, cast this mysterious mask to commemorate him. The ancient Shu kingdom had many forests that were shrouded in mist. It was the wish of the Shu people that they have sharp eyes that could penetrate the haze, the same sharp eyes as King Sansong. It seems that these exotic bronze items could be part of the evidence that links the cultural relics of Sanxingdui to the legendary and mysterious ancient Shu kingdom. But why did these bronze figures, with such exotic faces, appear in the ancient kingdom? People and gods, in the days of innocence, in the era of myths. Deserted cities and mysterious masks unveil an ancient, unsolved mystery.
是在1986年的时候铸成的，据新闻眼球的地方呢，就是它的一双呈暴露状的双手。通高是2.62米，整个的人哈是1.72米，和我们现代的真人一般大小。那么它的身材比例。 又和今天的人有一点不一样，给人感觉是很变形、很夸张，但是他又很协调、很自然。他穿的衣服啊是三层，有人还认为这个他穿的衣服就是当年的丝绸。这种衣服有学者把它称为叫什么龙袍，相当于后世的龙袍。
In the center of each of the figure's hands, there is a cylindrical hole in the center. It would seem that they once held
something.首先，我们考虑这个青铜离刃像，它是一个什么身份？当时的话，应该是一个铜料比较珍贵的时代，啊，用这么多铜来铸造这样的一个人物形象，它的地位的话，肯定是。
应该是在人这个界面上，应该是属于低等级的。从他的这个站立姿势和穿的衣服，等等这些方面来看的话，他应该是一个巫师之类的，就是一个祭司这样的一个身份的一个人。The
high priest, the figure who most represents divine rights, stands barefoot at the altar, holding something in his hands. As he is presiding over some kind of major sacrificial ceremony, whatever it is he's holding must be closely related to the ceremony. In the two sacrificial pits at Sanxingdui, archaeologists have found a large number of jade items. In ancient times, when it came to sacrificial vessels for ceremonies of worship, more often than not, the material of choice was jade. It has thus been suggested that the priest might be holding some kind of jade sacrificial vessel. In 1974, a tomb dating back to around 800 BC was discovered in Shanxi. Inside the tomb were unearthed a large number of bronze ritual vessels, pottery items, and objects made of stone and jade. Archaeologists also found two statues, statues featuring hand gestures that are very similar to those of the bronze standing figure found at Sanxingdui.
它上面也有一个人像，然后是这样的，但是这应该左右扶手应该没摆，然后是那个他手上拿的那个东西，再仔细的观察的话，比较接近于我们所认识的玉琮。A
jade song has two major features: a square column which represents the earth, and a round hole in the center that represents heaven. It was believed to have the power to connect heaven and earth.
有学者认为他手中可能拿的是玉琮，但是玉琮我们都知道是内圆外方的，而立人像的手明显的是环状的，所以这个不太实际。
因为他这个两个手，一高一低，那看上去的话就像是拿了一个，就是比较长一个东西。
因为他那个手里面的东西，直线的东西，管穿不进，它有角度，有错开的，一般认为是象牙。只有象牙比较合适，因为象牙它就是一个弯曲的，有弧度的东西。除了象牙之外，想不出它可能还拿什么东西。One
of the reasons scholars think the figure is holding a tusk is that among the numerous exquisite items unearthed from the pits in Sanxingdui were 73 tusks. Interestingly, more than 100 tusks have been unearthed from the Jinsha ruins, which date back to a period that is slightly later than Sanxingdui.
Sanxingdui 祭祀坑里边出土的象牙，它是比较完整的。那么根据我们以往的考古发现来推测的话，就这种完整的象牙。 再结合三星堆祭祀坑里边出土其他器物的一个性质来判断，象牙它的这些象牙的功能呢，可能是作为祭祀用的。那么象牙的话，那么作为祭品的话，我想是给神灵相应该说是最珍贵的、最灵动的一种祭品。
Today, the tusks are on display in various museums. And visitors who see them are curious to find out exactly where these precious tusks came from.
From this ancient perspective, in Chengdu, there was not yet found a evidence of the growing象牙of this kind.
Are there any more northern? 族群或者古国，他们的贡献或者通过交换得来的，现在也不能排斥这种可能性。In
addition to the tusks found at Sanxingdui, archaeologists have also found seashells. 巴舒 was a closed inland kingdom, far from the sea. So how did these seashells make it all the way to Sanxingdui? Why were they in the kingdom of Shu?
海贝，像这类东西，估计就是贝和象的话，都是从南方运来，不是本地生产的。这些海贝毫无疑问是海里来的。那么。
这种海贝呢有几种，其中的一种它是来源于这个印度洋。The year 2007 witnessed the discovery of the Nha Lap ruins in Vietnam. The ruins date back more than 3,000 years to the Phung New Win period. It isn't difficult to see that these ivory tablets unearthed from a site in Vietnam look very similar to those found at Sanxingdui.
那证明就在当时的话，就说是，现在的越南 北部就是这个范围了，就是在至少在这个交通贸易方面啊，是互相通畅的啊，有文化的交往的。
We can also find gold objects of similar style to the masks of Sanxingdui much further away in the land that was once ancient Greece. And in present-day Egypt, some tribal leaders still hold gold scepters that are similar to the one found at Sanxingdui.
权杖用这个杖来代表权力，是这个两河流域文明，啊，西亚文明的特征。那么在三星堆出现这种文化现象，他们之间可能会存在某种关联，某种文化的交流。
In the year 138 BC, the emperor of the Han Dynasty dispatched his envoy, Zheng Qian, to the western regions. Shortly thereafter, the Silk Road was gradually opened up, an event which marked the beginning of cultural exchanges between China and the West.Is it possible that 4,000 years ago, well before the time of the Han Dynasty and Zheng Qian, the ancient kingdom of Shu had a similar connection with the Middle East and West Asia?
那么这个交流的途径也学者们也认为就是说是通过南方丝绸之路，也或者叫西南丝绸之路，就是说从成都平原出发，经过云南，然后到印缅和两河流域文明之间有一种互相的这个交流。
More than 5,000 years ago, in this land of legends and myths, the ancient people of Sanxingdui found there was an abundance of mineral resources in the mountains and rivers of the area they inhabited. Gradually by sea, they established contact with the outside world, and at the same time, they developed a smelting technology that reached the highest level. They used this technology to create objects conceived in their wildest imaginations and imbued them with an air of mystery. To honor the gods with only the very best, they prepared elephants, livestock, jade, and other precious items to present as sacrifices.Enshrined on a high altar was a giant bronze mask and a bronze standing figure. The high priest, barefoot and wearing a robe, ascended the altar. He waved a scepter and prayed to the gods. But why, at some later date, were these divine bronze figures burnt and buried in what was obviously a great rush? What was it that led to this destructive act?The archaeological excavation at Sanxingdui in 1986 removed the veil of mystery from not only Sanxingdui, but also the ancient kingdom of Shu. Today, these broken bronze figures, now restored to their former glory by archaeologists, can be viewed in various museums. But their appearance is only the beginning of the real mystery.A once flourishing ancient city was destroyed and abandoned, leaving behind only these broken cultural relics to be repaired. Now scientists are about to restore them using the latest advanced technology. But will they succeed? Join us for part two of the mystery of Sanxingdui.